decided to start a new spotlight series, where I focus on a certain person from the 1920s and highlight their importance. The first person for this series is actor and filmmaker Buster Keaton, the great Stoneface. But why was he such an important figure? Let's find out.
I don't know why I stay home each night when you say your phone. You don't, and I'm left alone.
Born in Peak, Kansas on October 4th, 1895, his real name was Joseph Frank Keaton. His parents were Joseph Keaton and Myra Cutler, who were both vaudeville performers. As a young child, Buster was also a performer in the vaudeville circuit. The show was owned by his father, Joseph, and Harry Houdini. One explanation as to how he got the nickname Buster is usually explained with this story. As a toddler, Keaton fell down a flight of stairs and emerged uninjured. Harry Houdini supposedly said, "That was a real Buster." Buster meant a serious fall. All of the family's vaudeville shows would contain a scene where Keaton was thrown to various places, where he would almost always emerge uninjured. This led to his image as being the boy who can't be damaged. He also developed his famous stone face during these vaudeville years. When being thrown, he used to laugh, which received less applause from the audience, so he changed to having no expression. He only became literate as an older child, much later than most, and was taught by his mother. He moved away to New York with his mother at age 21 because of his father's alcoholism. He served in the U.S. Army during World War I, but did not see any action. However, during these years, his hearing was permanently damaged from a bad ear infection. That same year, in February 1917, he met the popular film comedian Fatty Arbuckle in New York City. His debut film was as a co-star with Fatty Arbuckle in his comedy shorts, appearing in 14 until 1920. In 1920, he made his first appearance as the star of a feature-length film, The Saphead. This was where his career really took off. Now that he had full creative control over his work, he used it to his full advantage. Keaton took on the roles of writer, director, and lead actor in his shorts. Between 1920 and 1923, he made 19 shorts. Then he moved on to more ambitious projects. Beginning in 1923, he began directing and acting in his own feature films. He was also the writer for two of them. Between 1923 and 1928, he made 10 feature films, which are regarded as his greatest legacy. Buster also became famous for sporting his unique pork pie hats, which he made himself by modifying regular hats. He wanted a unique look for his films, like his contemporaries Harold Lloyd and Charlie Chaplin. Straw hats were too breakable for his stunts, so he began making and wearing the stiff pork pie hats. In 1921, he married Natalie Talmadge, the sister of silent film stars Norma and Constance Talmadge, and the sister-in-law of Joseph Schenck, who was Keaton's boss. Together they had two sons, James and Robert. During the 1920s, Keaton was one of the most popular film actors, being the third piece in the trifecta of silent film comedians, along with Harold Lloyd and Charlie Chaplin. Keaton also had a lifelong interest in trains, which is evidenced in some of his films, namely Our Hospitality and most famously in The General. Although The General is now considered Keaton's masterpiece, it did not do that well at the box office when it was released in 1926. That was probably because the film is not as outright funny compared to his others. Although this film is often singled out as his best, in my opinion, it's impossible to pick a favorite Buster Keaton movie or short. The best ones all have a unique flair that only he could provide. Even in adulthood, Buster continued his reputation as being unbreakable by the daring stunts he performed in his films. Perhaps the most famous is seen in Steamboat Bill Jr., when the side of a building falls on him save for one precise spot. If the stunt had failed, it would have killed him. And in Sherlock Jr., he broke his neck during the filming while performing this stunt, and never knew about the injury until 9 years later during a doctor visit. Buster Keaton was also an innovator. Take this sequence from Sherlock Jr., for instance. He was measured with surveying equipment for each change of scene, giving the illusion of maintaining the same position while the scenery changed around him. Thank you. And in this clip of a 1921 short, The Playhouse, Keaton appears with other versions of himself that make up a band. The complex and ingenious method that Keaton used remained a mystery until he revealed the process decades later, when there was a mild resurgence of interest in silent film. And how about this impressive double exposure in Sherlock Jr.? This film was especially filled with numerous camera tricks. Bad times arrived for Keaton in 1928, however, when he signed a contract with MGM. He later regarded this as his worst mistake. The first film he made with the studio was The Cameraman. Here, Keaton is still up to his usual clever tricks and directed the film. He also directed a second film for MGM, but things began to take a turn for the worse. MGM soon deprived Keaton of being creatively involved with the films he made with them, and the quality certainly suffered as a result. Additionally, Keaton was no longer allowed to perform his own stunts, which were now done by a studio stunt double. By the sound film era, Keaton would never gain back his earlier popularity, despite regularly appearing in film throughout the 1930s. During this time, Keaton would suffer from alcoholism, which hurt his family life for a period. He got divorced twice during the 30s. He later married again in 1940, this time lasting for the rest of his life. During the 1940s, he was in various feature films, but nothing very popular. In 1950, Keaton had a short-lived television show, The Buster Keaton Show. He also appeared in the Charlie Chaplin film, Limelight, in 1952. In the 1950s, many of Keaton's films were re-released, and he made numerous television appearances. In 1957, he was featured on This Is Your Life, and starred in a Twilight Zone episode in 1961. He also appeared in the CBS special, A Tribute to Stan Laurel, in 1965, along with many other notable celebrities. In 1966, he was diagnosed with lung cancer, but was told that it was not terminal. He died on February 1st, less than a month later. He had made his last film appearance earlier that year, and it was released posthumously. Buster Keaton has two stars on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, one for film and one for television. Although the prime of his career was in silent film, which is unfortunately a forgotten era, he is still regarded as one of the greatest comedians of all time. Buster Keaton was part of the flourishing silent film scene of the 1920s, and was one of the leading creative forces in Hollywood when his career was cut unfortunately short by the bad decisions of one studio. Of the three most important silent film comedians, he had the shortest popular career span. But during that time, he made some truly creative and lasting films. I hope you enjoyed this video and learned something about one of my favorite figures of the 20s and in the history of film. If you have any suggestions of topics you would like to see me cover, please let me know in the comments. That's all for now, all you sheiks and gals out there, but stay tuned for more tales from the Jazz Age.